We've nailed down prices on 100 trade bestsellers for 100 days. That means you don't have to worry about prices going up, so you can quote with confidence and get on with the job. Shop in-store at B&Q or at tradepoint.co.uk and get all you need when you need it. Thank you.
been loading forever.
Save yourself from broadband nightmares with Unbreakable Wi-Fi. Only BT's hybrid broadband is backed up by EE, the UK's best network.
Every 4 years, we learn that football is not just a sport. It's a movement. Inspiration. It's in all of us.
Kia, movement that inspires.
Thank you. morning delivery with one substitution. Heinz beans.
But beans means... the tastiest of tea times! Think outside the toast!
Nice work, Mark.
It's beans, means...
Heinz! save yourself from broadband nightmares with unbreakable Wi-Fi. Only BT's hybrid broadband is backed up by EE, the UK's best network.
Good help is simply knowing wherever they are, day or night, your employees have access to a GP by phone or video with AXA Health. We're here to help everyone find their feel good health.
Join me on Little's YouTube channel to see how I made these sausage rolls with Serena.
This is when you really feel like a chef.
In it. Sriracha, the starring ingredient.
Can I eat one?
Oh my God, please do.
Guys, so this is the game everyone's been talking about. Avani, the King's Return. I'll try it out for you today. Rumor has it that 99% of the players are stuck at level 5. All right, I'm starting out smoothly. Yes, let's release the Monitor to kill this monster. What?
Wow, yes.
I can pull this pin off. Oh my god.
No.
Treasure is gone. It does take some brains to pass the levels. Download now and see if you can do it.
Thank you.
When you're in the trade, time is money, and shopping around means less time on the job. At TradePoint, we've a huge range of products under one roof. You can click and collect in 1 hour or get free bulk delivery to site to help you save time. Get all you need when you need it at TradePoint.
lunch gathering. You've got the Christmas spirit. You shall always be a good sport.
Polar bear.
Salmon.
And never ever give up.
And you are all doing different things.
Spirits like yours deserve long-lasting bubbles like these. Schweppes, we've got the tonic, you've got the spirit.
One 27 in the morning, I'll be up before you know it, but I'm wide awake, quite my way. Every time I see your number, I can't help but answer, do you do the same? When you see my name, so come on, give me all of your secrets, come on over, I promise I'll keep them. We can lay here and listen to the weekend, every minute till the weekend. If I'm gonna be tired all day, cause you got me staying up so late, reading into every word you say. Then why am I not waking up with you in this bed? Don't you tell me that we're not there. We can lay here and listen to the weekend, every minute till the weekend. If I'm gonna be tired all day, cause you got me staying up so late, reading into every word you say. Why am I not waking up with you in this bed? Don't you tell me that we're not there yet. I've been waiting since the day we met.
My name is Scott Harrison.
Just listen.
This is my wife, my son, and my one on the way. I lead an organization called Charity Water, and our mission is to bring clean water to everyone on the planet. I live in New York City now, but I didn't always. I grew up in suburbia, and this was my house. My dad was a businessman, and my mom was a writer. They loved each other, and they loved me. We were a happy family, until we weren't. When I was 4 years old, my mom collapsed on the bedroom floor. We'd just moved into a new house, and our house had a carbon monoxide gas leak, but none of us knew it until then. She didn't die that day, but her immune system did. She became allergic to everything. Perfume, the ink from books, radio waves. She wore strange masks all the time and was often connected to oxygen. The toxic gas destroyed her immune system and, in a way, my childhood too. After the poisoning, our roles reversed. and I began to take care of her. As the only child, I had to be a good one. I learned to cook, do laundry, and take care of the house. I was a good Christian kid who played piano in church and wanted to be a doctor when I grew up to help sick people like her. Until I turned 18. Music was my escape, so I joined a band and moved to New York.
Right about the time when the band broke up, I got involved in producing these like live music shows in the city.
I realized that you could actually get paid in New York City to drink alcohol for free. This job was called a nightclub promoter. So you just had to get beautiful people in the clubs. And if you got the right people in the clubs, you could charge guys $500 to buy a bottle of champagne that cost you $40.
I moved from club to club to club, filling up the VIP section and flashing my Rolex to the club photographers. For almost 10 years after that, I smoked 2 packs of cigarettes a day and was out drunk almost every night. I was into strip clubs, gambling, and just about every drug except heroin. On New Year's Eve, we all went to Punta del Este. It's a kind of party town in Uruguay. We rented this incredible house with cooks, waiters, and magnums of expensive champagne. Although it looked glamorous on the outside, there was a long decline in happiness. And I remember just feeling so unhealthy about it all. The next day, the party was still going, but I wanted the music to stop.
I realized I was spiritually bankrupt, I was emotionally bankrupt, I was certainly morally bankrupt.
I tried to find my way back to a very lost faith. I wanted things to be different. I left nightlife, sold almost everything I owned, and decided to take 1 year off to try serving others instead of myself.
I'm applying, I'm filling out these long applications for these very credible humanitarian organizations that have long histories. I put in the applications, and then I wait. And I guess I should not have been surprised, but I am denied by all of these organizations. They won't even let me volunteer because of my past.
So they're like, what do you do again? We're serious people. Thankfully, one organization says, if you pay us $500 a month, you can volunteer with us. So I said, here are my credit card details. Where are you guys going?
They were an amazing team of doctors and surgeons who traveled the world on a hospital ship. They specialized in removing facial tumors, and they were going to Liberia, one of the poorest countries in the world, and a country I'd never even heard of.
I say, I'm gonna sign up and be your volunteer photojournalist. I'd always taken pretty good pictures and photos and loved telling stories. Everything in my life changed. I decided in one fell swoop to kind of never smoke again, to never touch drugs again, you know, to never gamble again, to, you know, to swear off pornography and strip clubs, and just, I needed to walk so far in the other direction. And I walked up this gangway, and this became my new home.
Nothing could have prepared me for what I was about to see.
Hi, my name is Scott. I think we may be able to help you.
I met a man named Harris. He was suffocating to death with a benign tumor. I got to see Harris's transformation because of an amazing surgeon named Dr. Gary Parker.
So we've got to get your blood nice and strong for an operation, huh?
Dr. Gary had moved his entire family on the ship to volunteer for a short time. That was 29 years ago. He'd just never left. I'd never met anyone with that kind of dedication before.
Very happy we can schedule and he'll spend Christmas here. First good Christmas in 13 years.
A couple weeks later, I got to take Harris back home to his village with an entirely new face, ready to start a new life.
The uniform that's put on people when you have these terrible deformities is you're rubbish, you're worthless, you're spiritually cursed, and when you can change the uniform, it's huge. And the person starts to imagine that they might not be rubbish after all. No one in our world is rubbish.
There was one day when more than 5,000 sick people came to see our doctors. Some of them had walked for more than a month. But there were too many of them, and we just didn't have enough doctors. I remember holding my camera, crying. We had to turn thousands away. We were changing individual lives every day, but I wanted to do even more. I'm documenting these life-changing surgeries, but I started to spend more and more time out in the rural villages. And as I would travel around these villages, I would see the most shocking things.
75 people living here. This is what they're drinking. I can see there's bugs crawling around here.
I'm sort of putting this together, saying, look, thousands of people are turning up sick, and the most basic need for health isn't even met. It wasn't okay. Kids shouldn't be drinking from scummy swamps or ponds or rivers. He came here to fetch water?
Yeah.
And a crocodile
fell into the river.
And a crocodile snatched him.
Disappeared everywhere. Not even a body was not even found.
There were so many diseases caused by bad water. Cholera, dysentery, trachoma, bilharzia, things I'd never even heard of. On top of that, I found out people weren't just drinking this filthy water, they were breaking their backs to get it. Women and girls are usually the ones responsible, often walking for hours every day. As a result, many girls never make it through school. They trade in their education and dreams to carry 40-pound jerry cans so their families can have water. Dirty water is responsible for more death in the world than all forms of violence, including war. Even if it were a million people, this would be a crisis. But it's not 1 million. It's 785 million people who live on our planet right now without access to clean water. That's twice the population of the United States. Nearly 1 in 10 people worldwide. Behind those statistics were real lives, people who were dying because they couldn't get clean water. And many of them were children. I began to become really interested in the water issue and who was doing something about this. How come more people weren't talking about water? I came back to New York City ready to go.
So I started with a party. It's the only thing I knew how to do. I was a nightclub promoter. So I got someone to donate a club. I threw my 31st birthday party. I got 700 people to come out. I lured them with open bar. And I charged them $20 at the door. And this time, instead of pocketing the $15,000, we took it immediately to a refugee camp in northern Uganda. We built three wells. We fixed three wells. And then we sent the photos and the GPS and the story back to those 700 people. This was a big deal. People could not believe that a charity would bother to report to them on a $20 gift and that something actually happened with the money that they could see, that they could connect with.
700 people proved that we could make a difference, even $20 at a time. This was the beginning of Charity Water. As I'm talking about setting up a charity, I realize that so many of my friends don't trust charities. In fact, I learned that 42% of people in America alone don't trust charities. From the beginning, I was determined to do things differently, and I had a few big ideas. First, we'd handle money differently. From day one, Charity Water made a bold promise that 100% of all donations would go directly to clean water. I opened up a separate bank account for overhead, and we never touched the water money to pay for things like staff salaries, office rent, or travel expenses. We started looking for generous people with the resources to cover those overhead costs. Second, we proved each water project we funded. We put photos and GPS coordinates on Google Maps and even attached GPS trackers to drilling rigs so people could follow them. Later, we created and installed thousands of remote water sensors so we'd know that the projects continued to work over time. and even how much clean water was flown. Third, we believe for the work to be sustainable, it had to be led by locals.
Water and sanitation program creates an enabling environment so that all aspects of development can take off.
In the beginning, usually a handful of people were in the office every single day. And it was funny back then because we were trying to look so professional and put together when if you just walked in the office and saw how we did what we did, we had no idea what we were doing. And we were just making everything up as we went.
We built outdoor exhibitions, staged water walks, and designed ads that made people think differently about water. We got space on buses and taxis donated, spreading the word to everyone we could. We took over the windows of luxury retailers and created a TV commercial that ran for free to more than 20 million people. People started to take notice, and thousands began to donate. People all around the world started donating their birthdays to raise money for clean water. A 7-year-old named Max went door to door asking for $7 donations, and he raised $22,000. Maggie Moran gave up her 16th birthday. Nona Ween gave up her 89th.
Gave up my 28th birthday for charity water.
My 25th birthday.
39th birthday.
25th, 36th.
38th.
44th.
And this movement of birthdays begins to spring up, and people said, look, I don't need any more stuff. That's exactly what Rachel Beckwith said. She heard me speak a few months before her 9th birthday and told her mom that instead of presents or a party, she wanted to raise $300 to help kids get clean water to drink instead. She was disappointed when she didn't reach her goal, but she raised $220, and her mom assured her it was good enough. She could try again next year. She never got that chance. A few weeks later, Rachel lost her life in a car accident.
Well, just at 9 years old, Rachel Beckwith already had a legacy. Hers was charity water.
NBC's Lee Cowan explains how even now, Rachel Beckwith continues to make a difference.
Hundreds of strangers started to give $9 in her honor. Then it became thousands. Within weeks, Rachel's fundraising campaign had raised over $1.2 million for clean water. The heart of this 9-year-old girl inspired 32,000 people to give. But it didn't stop there. 80,000 people pledged their birthdays like Rachel.
Some people said, I can't wait until my birthday. I just need to fundraise now. I need to do something about this now.
Guys shaved their beards. Complete strangers started climbing mountains to raise money for clean water. Walking and biking across countries. Sailing across oceans.
I've been giving up Christmas gifts for 5 years. I've raised just above $32,000.
I did 12 lemonade stands for charity water.
I raised $10,000 for clean water.
Rachel reminded us that charity water wasn't just our story. And she's now been joined by over 1 million people, helping us fund over 50,000 water projects that will bring clean water to more than 11 million people. And I got to see just how much impact one life really can have when I took Rachel's family to Africa.
We greatly love Rachel and continue to love her family. And I'm overwhelmed with how greatly you have honored her memory. Please receive my most deepest and heartfelt thanks. You've done us a great honor today, so thank you. Yeah.
Rachel, develop.